What really is Central Europe? The basic problem that prevents a specific answer to the question is that there are many Central Europes in the European and global awareness. For some researchers, the term is synonymous with the Visegrad group. For the economist, also Slovenia is placed in Central Europe. And according to geographers, even such countries as Liechtenstein, Germany, Austria, and Switzerland are Central European countries. We can note that the variability of the borders of Central Europe depends on geographical and economic factors, which force the Europeans to create certain classification and segregation in order to organize Europe in some way. The real problem appears when people try to determine the cultural borders of Central Europe. The main issue is not the question how to shape cultural boundaries of Central Europe, but rather the main question is, does something like Central Europe exist? Czesław Miłosz wrote, "I assume there is such a thing as Central Europe, even though many people deny its existence." Beginning with the statesman and journalist who persists in calling it Eastern Europe, and ending with my friend Josef Brodsky, who prefers to reserve for it the name of Western Asia. In these decades of the 20th century, a Central Europe seems to exist only in the minds of some of its intellectuals. Polish Nobel Prize winner is not the only intellectual for whom the question of the existence of Central Europe plays a key role in the discussion of the identity of this part of the old continent. Czech essayist Josef Krotfor, in his contemplation about the identity of the Central European, also concludes that this term is perhaps understandable only by meteorologists who forecast the weather. Indeed, it is impossible not to agree with the Czech author that the existence of Central Europe in a meteorological and geographical map of the world or in the calculation of economists is not a problem. But when a question of separate identity and culture of the inhabitants of this part of Europe appears, this trait becomes not only problematic. Many people also have called into a question the existence of this region, which in the economic and geographical discourse is clearly defined. For the majority of Europeans, there is not such thing as Central Europe, because in the collective consciousness, the old continent is divided into East and West, or sometimes it is also one common place outside very foggy and then completely strange borderlands, which are called the East, and which rest on the borders of Ukraine, or often even closer. Where is the beginning of the borders of Central Europe, and whether such boundaries actually exist? If so, where to look for the roots of this region, which according to Czesław Miłosz exist only in the minds of local thinkers and intellectuals? Czech essayist Milan Kundera is widely believed to be the main initiator of the discussion about the existence of Central Europe. Discussion which began during the second half of the 20th century, more precisely in the 80s, which were already a harbinger of changes in this part of Europe, having once again brought closer to the West. Why there was no need of separating this part of Europe from its western and eastern parts in the previous centuries? In ancient times, most of the area today recognized as territories of Central Europe was outside the Roman limes and thus the civilized world. Our regions were even not affected by the lingua franca, which was identified as a sign of culture and civilization in Europe. Despite this, however, the countries of Central Europe, such as Poland, Czech Republic, and Hungary, have been included into the era of Christian European tradition, getting the Baptist from Rome. As a result, after the Great Schism, these countries were not only on the side of Western civilization and papal influence, but also assumed the role of defenders of the Christian Europe against its enemies, while defending its boundaries. In the 19th century, one of the professors of the University of St. Petersburg said that the special achievement of the Polish state was the fact that it did not allow the destructive Western culture penetrate Russia. Indeed, Poland and the other Central European countries served as a barrier, separating themselves from the influence of the West and East. On the other hand, Central Europe acted as not only a barrier, but also as a connector and place of dialogue of two separate cultures, which also had a strong influence of its inhabitants. This created a culturally unique region, an uncommon combination of value and influences borrowed from both East and West cultures. The cultural bridge was, according to John Paul II, a great strength of Central Europe, which could breed with the both lungs of Christianity and a common European cultural heritage, which before the Great Schism were a unity, referring to the common and long Christian tradition. However, in the 16th and 17th centuries, in the Polish consciousness, constituting border between Eastern culture and the Western concept of the East did not have a negative connotation. Contrary, East was associated with great and inspiring culture and had an important place in Polish culture. This situation changed after the partitions, when the connotations with the East began to be associated mainly with Russia and its policy of conquest. The triumph of capitalism in Europe was critical for the concept of the East. The new order created distinction between rich, advanced capitalist Western countries and passive, exploited countries of the East, which permanently enrolled in the European consciousness. At the same time, there was a clear separation of Europe into East and West, which raised the inhabitants of Central Europe express a strong desire to separate from the civilization of the East, commonly being associated with the economic backwardness. When can we look for the roots of Central Europe, which exist as a separate community in the minds of its intellectuals? We must remember how culturally diverse era we are talking about, because of the large cultural differences as well as the multitude of the nations of Central Europe, I suggest to use in the context of this community the term ethnia, proposed by Anthony D. Smith. According to British researcher, ethnia is an ethnic collectivity, which includes the differences and similarities between modern national wholes and feelings and collective cultural wholes and feelings of previous eras. Characteristic of ethnia are elements such as the need of identify within the community in order to gain individual identify based on historical and cultural community. Smith notes that the core of ethnia is transmitted in the historical record that shapes the individual's experience of the community. Ethnia is thus a kind of community based on common values, which create collective identify and purpose. Anthony D. Smith notes that each ethnia must have a common origin myth and the common experience of the past, explaining the origin, evolution, and destiny of the community. I think that this common myth of origins and history should be treated as a cultural roots of community called Central Europe. So where could we find an origin myth of Central Europe? Milan Kundera decided that the most important in the study of the roots and traditions of Central Europe are aesthetic and cultural categories. As argued, Baroque set a centennial unity to the multinational area. Kundera said that the expression of this community could be found especially in music, which, according to the Czech writer, is best way of expressing the values of Central Europe and their impact on the whole continent. Czesław Miłosz wondered about the borders of his native region in the context of the architectural borders, also finding the Baroque as the common elements. As he wrote, "It's not easy to draw the borders while walking through the streets of her cities. It is difficult to doubt her stubborn life, whether it might be my Baroque Vilnius or in the other Baroque Prague, whether in the Middle Age and Resistance Dubrovnik." Joseph Crowther claimed that the spirit of Central Europe is best visible in the literature of this region, as he argued, is the sense of absurdality, narrowness, and a kind of melancholy, leading to catastrophic vision that is characteristic of Central European writers, which include Franz Kafka, Jaroslav Hack, Bruno Schulz, and Milan Kundera. It should be noted that this catastrophism, which translates into our search for Central European identity, is characteristic not only for Milan Kundera, but also for Czesław Miłosz, who in his youth was a catastrophist. Chilchots of Czesław Miłosz and Milan Kundera took place in the post-war, the Versal order, when both Poland and Czechoslovakia gained independence after years of enslavement by neighbor powers. The newly established state was not treated on par with the Western European countries, but rather treated as a dependent and unstable republic in Eastern Europe, which was caused by economic factors equating Western capitalism and the modern economy. Jan Kiniewicz wrote that Poland, in the era of independence, was recognized by Western countries as an Eastern country, same as Czechoslovakia and Hungary. The newly established countries tried to hide his Easternity at all cost, fighting to eliminate elements of Eastern culture and adapt to the standards of Western capitalism and perception. All this caused great difficulties and sudden changes in the identity of the inhabitants of Central European countries, who were brought to the superpower vision suddenly, felt as an inferior and unwanted cousins of their Western neighbors. This had a very significant impact on the mainstream of catastrophism, which Claude forementioned and which has intensified even after the Second World War. It turned out that Central Europe is not wanted by Western countries, which easily agreed to donate them in the influence of Stalin. Lowering the Iron Curtain was an event which, like no other, separates Central Europe from Western, brutally snatching Central Europe with her roots, which the region shared with the Western Europe. I would like to recall one more description of Central Europe by Joseph Crutford, which described this part of Europe. He wrote, "Over Central Europe, there rise the heavy smell of boiled cabbage, stale beer, and the soapy whiff of overripe watermelons. The front lines are vast and irrational, and it's only the smell which permits to identify the region with absolute centrality." It is necessary to ask a question at this point whether these words of Czech essayist are not the most important in the search of the roots of Central Europe, especially that also Czesław Miłosz gave a special role to the air and atmosphere of Central Europe. As Nobel Prize winner spoke, the air in America is incredibly light and refreshing. But Miłosz, as man of Central Europe, had a big problems to get used to the local air. In Miłosz's opinion, not capitalism and not modernity were main factors which apparently different Poland from the United States, but just the air and atmosphere, refreshing and devoid of melancholy, which led Poles to drink vodka. Air turned out to be for a Pole an impassable barrier and obstacle. Miłosz felt lost due to lack of that melancholy, which turned out to him suddenly extremely valuable and needed. We are unable to determine the real boundaries of this region in fair and completely neutral manner. If, as Norman Davies and Timothy Garton Ash say, Central Europe is a spiritual community which people can draw by using physical front lines, then maybe we should look for the core of the community at this very characteristic melancholy, which can be felt in the air, and her traces could be found in the literature, music, and fine arts. This melancholy is a trace of the past and the history of the region, which, according to Miłosz, was marked by the constant oppressions by the Turks, Austrians, Germans, and Russians. Indeed, the history of Central Europe is associated with the desire to impose a new identity to the region by its successive occupants. However, the most tragic episode for the Central European was post-war period, not only because of the greater separation of Central Europe from the West by the Iron Curtain, The real problem was Stalin's attempt to snatch the Central Europe with all of his roads, not only Western, but also Eastern, which together form a whole. Soviet leader wanted to create a region without history and identify in Central Europe, a region which was defined only by vodka, beer, and boiled cabbage. On the other hand, a strong separation from the West world and the East, based on melancholy and common historical experience, helped in the 80s of the 20th century to create a specific community of nations, ethnia, characterized by a community of origin, experience, and objectives. Once again, I would like to recall the words of Karol Wojtyła, who said that special and huge strength of Central Europe is possibility to breathe not only by one, but two lungs of Europe, which should constitute a whole. Other regions do not already have a such possibility. The people of Central Europe usually feel some interiority in relation to the West, which often makes it impossible to promote their ideas and identify. Unfortunately, there is still the old belief that vodka, beer, and cabbage are the only valuables that Central European countries can bring to the European community. Couldn't we instead think that our experience and multicultural roots are the most treasured values, which might again transform Central Europe into a bridge between East and West and start a cultural dialogue, which is extremely necessary nowadays? Thank you very much for attention.